delighted to be with you tonight. I've looked forward to this since the invitation was extended. I count it a privilege and a pleasure to be invited into the community and asked to share in the telling of the old, old story. And that's certainly the case tonight. My assignment, not my will, but thy will be done. The text is Matthew 26, 36 through 46, with parallels in Mark 14, 32 through 42, and in Luke 22. We're only going to read the section from Matthew's Gospel, and we'll reference both Mark and Luke's accounts. John says nothing about the prayer in the garden. Just happened. Now it's back on. Did you notice that, or my imagination? You can't hear me. You go like this and then move forward. My granddaughter, my youngest granddaughter, is 3 years old. We were visiting last month, and when we were ready to leave, Sydney always wants to know, when are you coming back? And I said, Lord willing, in 2 weeks. And she looked up at me and said, no, Papaw, it's not Lord willing, it's God willing. That's what my says. So, God willing, we will deal with tonight's text, and hopefully when we've concluded, you can honestly say that it has been an enriching time in God's Word. Never come to hear a preacher. Always assemble to hear God's Word. The messenger doesn't matter. The message is what counts. And I know that Tom, who's nodding like this, is in full agreement. Text tonight I want to share with you. Luke tells us that it was Jesus' custom to enter the synagogue when he was home there in Nazareth. On one occasion, as was the custom, they handed him the scroll. He unrolled it to the place, and then he read in their hearing, and having read the text, he then gave them a message from that text regarding what Isaiah had written and its application, saying to them, today, in essence, in your hearing, this word from God's prophet is fulfilled. I believe that it is always important to simply open the book and read from it. And sometimes we don't do that as much as we probably should. And I'm trying more and more in my preaching and teaching. And I'm still somewhat busy, even though I'm semi-retired, to do as much reading from God's Word as I can. So listen carefully or follow along as we look at tonight's text. Now, I did bring my glasses this evening. I was at Camden Avenue last summer and forgot these. And when I had concluded and we were driving home, my wife said to me, you know, you read like a second grader. So I brought my glasses tonight so I can at least read like a sixth grader. 36 and following, then Jesus went with them to a place. Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. Taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful even to death. Remain here and watch with me. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, so could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. again for the second time, he went away and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, or were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words again. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour's at hand. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of Satan. Rise, let us be going." This is, as I understand the chronology of the final week in the life of our Lord leading up to his crucifixion, it's the evening. They had met in the upper room where he had instituted the Lord's Supper. It was also in that setting that he washed the feet of the disciples. And then John's record gives us a lengthy dissertation teaching from the lips of the Lord to the disciples leading up to the events that we've just read here in Matthew 26 in Gethsemane. Gethsemane is a compound word, two Aramaic / Hebrew words that mean literally oil press. It was located of olives, and this was a place that Jesus frequented during his ministry. So it would have been well known, not just to the 11 who accompany him, but to Judas as well, who will soon betray him. Break time, if you all like to prefer.
I thought I was pulling a Biden for a moment. Not trying to be offensive, just thought it was funny. This one's supposed to be red, right? Okay. I'm going to lay it down there and I don't have to take it off again. The other one was green. Didn't work, so I guess the red means go. Not green tonight. Now, where were we? We were talking about this being a place that was familiar to the disciples, and therefore Judas would have had no trouble at all knowing where Jesus was, because he will soon betray our master. At the entrance to the garden, Jesus left eight disciples and proceeded in with his three confidants, Peter, James, and John.
I think you're muted.
I'm muted.
Can you hear him?
I can hear it, so I'm sure it's working. Anybody else? It doesn't bother me, please. It really doesn't. Now, if I can just remember where we were. Oh, we're at the garden. He's just entered the gate with Peter, James, and John. Peter and the sons of Zebedee. Remember, it was those three who accompanied him to Jairus' house where he raised Jairus' daughter. And it was also those three who were with him on the Mount of Transfiguration in Matthew 17. He was clearly closer to those three than to the other nine, or in this case, now that Judas has contracted with his enemies to betray him, the other eight. In the garden, he separates himself, the record says, from those three disciples about the distance that a man can throw a stone. So I have no idea how far that would be. In the strict sense, it would depend on the man, I guess, but take an average of how far a man can throw a stone. And Jesus has left them in one place and asked them to watch and essentially pray that they enter not into temptation. And then he goes from them and he falls on his face and he pours out his heart to God. "Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me." The cup is the cup of sorrow, suffering, and shame that will come the following day at Calvary. Earlier in the ministry, in fact, in Matthew chapter 20, there is an incident in which James and John, two of the closest of those disciples, approach Jesus with the request, "When you come into your kingdom, can we sit at your right hand and your left hand?" Their mother also was involved in that request. Jesus' response was, "That's not something that I can promise. That's something that comes to those who actually earn it, not by going to the top, but by willingly going to the bottom. Because if you exalt yourself, you'll be abased. If you humble yourself, you'll be exalted. Their request was not an act of humility. It's generally thought, by the way, if you didn't know this, that their mother, Salome, and our Lord's mother, Mary, may have actually been sisters, and these two may have been his first cousins. That's speculation. There is perhaps some evidence to a degree that might back that up. I can't tell you with certainty, but I do know they had a closer relationship, and that having that kind of relationship led to this request, to which Jesus ultimately said, "Are you prepared to face the baptism that I will face and drink the cup that I will drink?" And they said yes, but I doubt at that instant they really understood what the Lord was talking about, because he is about to face the most horrid ordeal the human mind has ever devised, crucifixion. The guillotine, the hangman's noose, even the electric chair or lethal injection, they're all cakewalks compared to being nailed to a cross, put on public display, either naked or near naked, for all the world to see. It was the fate reserved for the vilest and wickedest in the empire, and yet the sinless Son of God, within 24 hours, at this time, even less, closer to 12, will face crucifixion. He was not afraid to die, my friend. I can tell you that with absolute confidence. Because he knew, as I hope all of us know in Christ, there is life after life, and that there is no need for us to fear death any more than he did. But his human nature was such that no right-thinking person would want to face crucifixion. And so it's only normal and natural that in the moment, as these events are all about to come to fruition, he had come into the world for this purpose, Isaiah 53. But it is not something that he longed for. If there is another way, if you can deliver me from this suffering and sacrifice, please do. But, and this is crucial, not my will, but your will be done. The record says that he prayed this prayer using the same words, though the translations differ slightly. The essence is that each time his request to the Father was the same. If there is another way, let's take it. But not my will, your will be done. But there was no other way. In Genesis 22, Abraham was called by God to sacrifice the son of promise. He, with son Isaac and two servants, went to the foot of Moriah, where the donkey and the servants were left, and Abraham and Isaac ascended the mountain, carrying the knife, the wood, and no doubt a fire stick of some kind. Here's the knife, here's the wood, where's the sacrifice? This is the question that Isaac raised with his father, Abraham. In 22:8, Abraham responded, "The Lord will provide himself a lamb." And as you may recall, just at the moment when Abraham, by faith, was about to follow through with the dictate of the Almighty, God stayed his hand, and Isaac was released, and the ram caught in the thicket was substituted. He died, or it died, where Isaac was destined to be slain. That actually prefigures what will play out the following morning at Calvary. Because as that ram took Isaac's place, Jesus took our place. He died for the sins of all humanity. God demands that the remedy for sin is blood. Without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission, Hebrews 9:22. But as you know, as students of the Bible, the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. Only the blood of the sinless Son of God could accomplish that. There was no plan B. And Jesus was okay with that. If it cannot be avoided, your will be done. And I suspect that the thing that he dreaded most was not, as I said, death, the suffering, the sorrow, and even the shame. It was that moment when he bore upon himself the sins of all humanity, and the Father looked away. And in that instant, he felt what it was like to be apart from his Father and our Father. And what a terrible, terrible feeling that must have been. He prayed, he returned, found the disciples asleep. But he said, "The spirit is willing, the flesh is weak." And when I read this story, that's one of the things that provides the greatest comfort to me. I have found over the years that wanting to do right and actually doing right are two entirely different things. And no matter how hard we might want to do something, sometimes because of our physical nature, we are limited in what we can do. When those times come, do not despair. Because the understanding that Jesus demonstrated to the three there in the garden will be manifested toward all of us when we too, with willing spirits, have weak flesh and do not live up fully to the demands of the Savior. And I'm so thankful that our judge is Jesus Christ, who has walked where we walk, who has encountered everything that we encounter. And though he overcame it all, he understands when we do not. And so, to use the argument of Hebrews 4, our great high priest is sympathetic, understanding, and forgiving. Though he did no sin, Peter said, and guile was never found in his mouth. And as the text in Hebrews 4 says, he was at all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He still gets it. He knows the frailties of the flesh. He understands our flawed nature. And he's not expecting from us perfection, just faithfulness. And that is, to me personally, tremendously encouraging, because I know I'm not perfect. But to the best of my ability, I strive every day to be faithful. And when I talk about that concept, it seems always necessary to put it in a way that everybody can understand. If I ask Nina if Tom was a perfect husband and she's honest, she's going to have to say no. He has some flaws. I don't know what they are, but he's human, and therefore he has to have them. But if I said, "Is he faithful?" and she's going to say absolutely, unequivocally, without doubt. And we understand that. That's what God wants from us. He knows that we are flawed. And so he's not demanding of us a sinless life. He is calling us to sin less, not to be perfect, but to be faithful. And in those times when, because of a weakness of the flesh or some other reason, not deliberate, premeditated or presumptuous sin, but those things that come accidentally through ignorance or through weakness or some other thing that causes us in a moment to lapse, he's understanding. Just as Jesus was understanding, he'd only asked him, stay awake and pray. But have you ever had the challenge of just staying awake? There's a television show my wife enjoys watching at 10 a.m. or 10 p.m. every night. I don't know that I see the end of it more than once a week at most, because I fall asleep. I might stay awake if I'm more interested, but I'm not. It's a political program, and I just don't care. But I get it. I know sometimes when you want to do something, the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. In this case, that was true. Now, what Jesus does is acknowledge something that is apparent to any Bible student. He acknowledges that God is in control, and above all else, for him and for all of us, our goal ought to be every day, to the extent possible, to do his will and not our own. Jesus said in the Gospel of John, in chapter 4:34, and chapter 5:30, and chapter 6:38, something along these lines. I did not come to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Could I say tonight with a certain degree of accuracy that that ought to be our attitude as well? That we are not put on this globe just to do things that please us. The real goal of God's child ought to be every day to do what we can and to live as we should to please him. After all, when Solomon concluded Ecclesiastes, he said, the whole of man, the King James says the whole duty, the Hebrew just says, the whole of man is to fear God and keep his commandments. This is our duty. Jesus said, my duty, my responsibility, my goal, my purpose, my reason for existing is to do the will of him who sent me. So it doesn't surprise me, and I suspect it doesn't surprise you either, that in this setting, when his heart is so heavy and he is so earnest in his prayer that drops of sweat drip from his brow like blood, and so weakened by the experience that an angel is dispatched from heaven to minister to him, as Luke's account tells us, he is still absolutely and completely determined to do whatever God, his Father and our Father, wants him to do. And I submit to you that that ought to be the case with all of us. When you look at Paul the Apostle and his ministry, you'll find him saying, in terms of his intentions or plans, if the Lord wills. For instance, Acts 18:21, I'll return to Antioch if the Lord wills. Or in 1 Corinthians 4:19, I will come to see you if the Lord wills. Two examples. There are many others. May I submit to you that every Christian ought to conduct life and make plans with the same understanding. James, the brother of our Lord, in his epistle in chapter 4, asked, what is your life? And then responded, a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away, a puff of smoke. One moment you see it, the next it's gone. You, speaking to his readers, make your plans, saying, I'll go into such and such a city and I will buy and sell and get gain. He doesn't condemn them for making plans. He doesn't condemn them for even wanting to be prosperous. But he says, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, if it's God's will, I will do such and such. Because in so doing, you're acknowledging the truth. God is sovereign. God is in control. He is ruler of the universe. It is his will that matters most, and his will that we should be seeking all the time. And that's what I learned from this exchange in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. That as surely as it was true for Jesus, it ought to be true for each of us every day. No matter what, good times and bad, God's will is what counts.
Now I want to do something that may surprise you. I want to go from this account in Matthew 26 to 2 Samuel chapter 10. And look at a story that underscores everything that we learn from this exchange and others that we have in the New Testament about God being in charge and His will, not ours, being what matters. In 2 Samuel chapter 10, the Ammonites have just lost their ruler. A man who had been cordial and kind to King David. And so when David got word that this king had died, he dispatched ambassadors to express his condolences. But they were perceived as being spies and looking for some pretext to invade. So they were not received warmly. In fact, their garments were cut off in the back, and half their beards were shaved off. And they were sent, metaphorically speaking, with their tails between their legs back home to David. David learned what had happened and said, "Stay until your beards grow back and then come into the city." But war would ensue. They had insulted King David and all of Israel, and there would be a battle to be fought as a result. This fight would be led by Joab and his brother Abishai against the forces of the Ammonites. And before this battle unfolds, I want you to hear what Joab says to Abishai and the army. It's in verses 11 and 12. Joab said, "If the Syrians are too strong for me, then you shall help me. But if the Ammonites are too strong for you, then I will come and help you. Be of good courage, and let us be courageous for our people and for our cities of God, of our God." And then this statement, "May the Lord God do what seems good to him." May the Lord do what seems good to him. Isn't that exactly what Jesus was saying there in the garden? I know what I want, and it's not the cross, but Lord God, Father, do what seems good to you. Now, if you read the remainder of the account, they were victorious. The Ammonites and their confederates were essentially destroyed. Remaining soldiers who did not perish went home. But it's not over. After the events that occur in chapters 11 and 12 regarding David and Bathsheba, they will fight the war against the Ammonites to its conclusion and take the city of Rabbah. Rabbah is modern Amman, Jordan. And Joab, who had been in charge of the forces, did not actually take the city. That was reserved for King David. So David was summoned when the city was about to fall and could take credit for another victory. But none of that is terribly important to what I want you to see this evening about that single statement, "May the Lord do what seems good to him." I have found this to be my prayer over and over and over again as I've gotten older. I've gotten older because I remember when Tom and I were young preachers. That was a long time ago. But I really do think that with age, if things are as they ought to be, you get a little wiser. And things that at one time concerned me greatly no longer do. I once thought that everything depended on me, and if there were problems, I had to fix them. They were probably my fault anyway, because that's the way the brethren always looked at it. But then I discovered something. I'm not in charge. God is. And all I need to do is say, God, do what seems good to you. And it'll be just fine. Not my will, but your will be done. You know, I look at the turmoil in our world right now. Man's inhumanity to man. Wars and famines and disease. And I just shake my head and say, God, you do what seems good to you. I don't know how much longer this world will stand. I've read Genesis 6. I know what Noah's world was like. In those days, every imagination of man's heart was on evil continually. And what also is said but is often overlooked is, and violence filled the land. How close are we to that again? I don't know. But my prayer is, I think, the same sentiments that Jesus expressed in the garden. May the Lord do what seems good to him. You know, I look at people battling cancer, diabetes, heart disease, and a host of other physical problems. And I know that we're to pray for those who are ill. James wrote, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much, in the context of praying for the sick. I know that Hezekiah the king was granted additional years of life because he poured out his heart to God. God heard him and responded. But I suspect your experience has been like mine. I prayed, I thought earnestly and fervently for folks to recover who never did. And I thought they would. If I didn't think God could heal, would any of us pray? But I also know sometimes healing is not the best outcome. And so I find myself always saying, may the Lord do what seems good to him. Sometimes it's really hard. When somebody that's so near and dear, you only want one outcome. But God really does know best. May he do what seems good to him. I look at struggling families, folks facing financial burdens, a lost job, business failure. And again, I pray, may the Lord do what seems good to him. And I will clue you in on something. Some of the greatest success stories in life began in abject failure. Success came not because they tried and succeeded, but because they tried and failed and tried again. That's still true. May I suggest to you that our God is not the God of second chances. He's the God of as many chances as we need in life to get it right. And he's not looking for us to get it right every time. He knows we will fall flat on our faces. What he's looking for is our willingness to get up and start over. May the Lord do what seems good to him. I look at a world similar in my judgment to the world that Paul encountered in Athens, where men worshipped and served the creature rather than the creator in the Roman Empire in Romans chapter 1, where they were so religious that they even had an inscription to an unknown god there in Athens. And I see militant atheism raising its ugly head all around us. May the Lord do what seems good to him. I know what I must do, what you must do. We must cling to truth and proclaim truth. And the truth has nothing to fear. The truth will ultimately win out. You'll know the truth. The truth shall make you free. But it's easy to get discouraged.
to think that the devil has the upper hand, but he doesn't. God, do what seems good to you. And then I look at the souls of lost men and women. Some have heard the gospel repeatedly and have yet to act, and others who have not heard it. And although it's not popular to say, those who have not heard it are still lost, not because they have not heard it, but because they are sinners, and the only remedy for sin is the blood of Jesus. And I'm compelled to do what I can do, but I'm just one, and not much at that. But if all of us would do what we could, and this is what Paul said was the basis of his ministry in Colossians 1, he preached the gospel to every creature under heaven whereof, he said, I, Paul, have been made a minister. If every Christian understood that they have a responsibility to proclaim God to the world with their lives and their lips, there'd be far fewer people facing judgment not having heard the story of Jesus. And there are people all over this globe, all of them made in the image of our Creator, who can only find salvation in Jesus Christ. Determined to do what you can in your home, in your community, and wherever you go, and pray, may the Lord do what seems good to Him. That's the essence, in my judgment, of what Jesus was conveying there in the garden that Thursday evening. It is what every Christian ought to do every day, to pour out his or her heart regarding the kinds of things that we've raised this evening and many others that could be added, and always say, God, you do what seems good to you. In that brief text here in 2 Samuel 10 and the parallel in 1 Chronicles 19, Joab said, be courageous. Do not fear. I don't want us to walk out of here in despair, thinking that we live in a terrible world where there are no victories, no joys, no triumphs. Just the opposite is true. This is a wonderful place God has made for us. And though not everyone appreciates it, not everyone uses it as they should, we are truly blessed. And called, therefore, to walk by faith, not by sight, 2 Corinthians 5, 7. To be courageous and to stand up and let our voices be counted for the cause of Christ. The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. He has not given us, meaning Christians, the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. I realize that the god of this world, as the scriptures tell us, is the devil. But I also know, because the scriptures tell us, that he is powerless unless we surrender to him. I am not willing to do that, are you? I know the world is in a mess. I know there are all kinds of problems out there, and you're probably encountering some right now, because all of us are either coming out of the throes of difficulty, are in the midst of them right now, or they loom on the horizon. But I don't say that to instill fear in your heart, but rather confidence that God is in control and He will see us through no matter what happens. But our prayer must always be, may God, may the Lord do what seems good to Him. And if that's our prayer and that's how we live our lives, we'll be able to say with the psalmist in the long ago, and I understand the context, but I think the application that I'm making tonight is just as valid. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm glad to be alive today. Thrilled to be a part of the kingdom of Christ. And rejoice in the hope of heaven that we all share, not because of our goodness, our righteousness, or our holiness, but because of His. Made possible because He did what God wanted Him to do. Not my will, He said, but your will be done. May we live our lives with the same commitment. Not my will, but your will be done.
And your will is for me to know your blessed Son as the Savior of mankind. Except you believe that I am He, Jesus said, you'll die in your sins, John 8:24. And a lot of our friends and neighbors stop and say, there it is, that's all you have to do. I'm so tired of turning on the TV and seeing somebody tell me I just need to pray this prayer and invite Jesus into my heart and take hold of the salvation He's promised, because you cannot see it in this book. It's not there. But most of our friends and neighbors believe it and will fall short. Because Jesus also said, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish, Luke 13:3-5. And repentance must be followed by confession and immersion. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. These are things that all of you know, and I know you know them, but are you sharing them with others? They may not want to hear them, but may the good Lord do what seems good to Him. When you've done your responsibility, met your responsibility, done your duty, they will know the truth, and the truth can set them free. So tonight, when you pillow your head, remember Jesus. And earnestly say, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. What a wonderful thing that is for Christians. And if you're not a Christian, you can be. He died to make that possible. You have the opportunity to obey Him tonight, if you so choose, or if you've lost your way, to be restored. But it is your choice and yours alone. We're praying for you. May the good Lord do what seems good to Him. Let's stand and sing the invitation song at this time.
By faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the light.